Greatness is found in history and in heroes. Greatness is rising above the ordinary. Greatness is the long, difficult road to being extraordinary. A series of documentaries profiling the lives of extraordinary leaders in the Ghanaian society. Sheikh Osman Nuhu Sharabutu. His greatest triumph lies in his legacy as a peace-building champion, a leader, a philanthropist, a humanitarian, and a teacher. That legacy stretches beyond the boundaries of Ghana to neighboring countries like Nigeria, Senegal, and Morocco, where he has publicly taking his teachings of the religion of Islam and the campaign for religious tolerance too. But how did this beautiful, sustained and progressively impactful journey all begin?
He was born in Kauli, where the father and mother lived in Kauli, just about 200 meters or 150 meters from where I stand. But behind me here is where the National Chief Imam was raised from cradle. This is where he lived with the mother. So I lead you to the house and I point you to the room that they lived in before he left here. Over there is where the room that His Eminence, the National Chief Imam, was raised. That's the room he lived with his mother till the age of about 8 when he started schooling and he was taken to Old Fadama.
Born on April 23, 1919, in the poor neighborhood of Zongo Lane, in the heart of Accra, Ghana's capital, Sheikh Osman Nuhu Sharabutu is the third of 11 children.
One of the things I really found out was that he wasn't born in Katsina in the northern region. Rather, his great-grandfather was born in Katsina in northern Nigeria. And his great-great-great-grandfather actually came from Syria, settled in Nigeria, gave birth to his great-great-grandfather, and then the route continued. He was born in Accra, not Katsina, not in Nigeria. He was born in Accra.
His father, Sheikh Nuhu bin Mohammed Sharabutu, a Beriberi with a Gurushi ancestry, was also an Islamic scholar. His mother, Aishetu Tasid Abbas, of a Sisala ancestry, also a Hafiza, meaning she successfully memorized the entire 114 chapters of the Holy Quran. The calm, non-violent Grand Mufti was ironically born into a family of warriors. His great-grandfather, Mohammed Danbano, the first ever black African officer of the British Army, and his brother, Officer Haris Zenua, aide-de-camp of the British governor, were very instrumental in the architecture of the colonial government in the 19th and 20th centuries on the African continent.
Muka yi karatu kamar shekara biyu. Shi malamin nan nawan a lokacin ba wani wanda ya san Nahu kamar sa a kuma shi ba wanda ya san Nahu kamar sa wanda suka zama almajiran kuma shi da yawa malluman nan shi ya bude musu ido ya wuce shi ya bude musu ido in baka zama almajirin sa ba ka zama kai karatu ba kai karatu ne ba kai karatu da almajirin sa shi muka zo bayan wannan kuma malluma manyan malluma sun zo ina bin suna neman karuwa a wurinsu na ilimi aka na tashi.
Usman was born with a rare gift. He could foretell the future sometimes. He had premonitions about people, places, and things.
Ya Allah ya mini falala a lokacin ina yawo. Ni kwanta kan kazunzumi ba su ci zuna. Kazunzumi ba su ci zuna. Ina yaro ban lokacin karatu na ba na kama da ibada. Ni tunanin wani abu ko mutuwa ne ya zo rajiciya na ka mutu. Ba ni ke cewa inda ya zo abin da ya zo zuciya na lokacin nan. Da lokacin nan na kama ibada da kadu. Shi aka ce shi ina so in shiga Tijjaniya. A lokacin nan ba yaro Tijjaniya. Shi rafa ni na Lima Abbas ya ce an bani. Wurin shekara 80 kenan. Shi ya bani ɗarikan Tijjaniya.
Like most children, Usman's mother, Aishatu Abbas, brought him up in the faith and teachings of the Holy Prophet Muhammad. At the age of 12, young Usman had mastered the recitation of the Noble Quran. His insatiable quest for Islamic knowledge spurred him on to memorize other books, including the Hadith, which is a compilation of the sayings of the Holy Prophet Muhammad, Islamic literature, and Islamic jurisprudence, also known as fiqh.
When you listen to the Chief Imam and he's breaking down Quranic text, even at this age, 102 years, you will be amazed. And sometimes you would mistakenly think that the Chief Imam, because of the age, he is growing senile, but he is mentally alert. And to prove his mental acuity and mental alertness, get him when he's interpreting the Quran and when he begins to break down the Arabic syntax, in fact, including etymology of the Arabic words. If you see him, and the way he goes into poetry or into poems, ancient Arabic poems that have been composed in different domains of Islamic life.
In the early 1940s, his father sent him to Kumasi in the Ashanti region to study under the highly revered scholar at the time, Sheikh Abdallah Dantano. But all along, young Usman wanted to study under the Grand Pioneer and Supreme Commander of the Tijaniya Path, Sheikh Alhaji Ibrahim Inyaz Al-Kaulak.
Is the Chief Imam, when you come close to him, he give you a sense of something more to the physical and external impressions, impressions and expressions of religion. He takes you to the inner side where you do not see. And yet those are the matters that matter for us in life. Then also, we talk of spiritual insight in terms of the spiritual environment and how the world of spirit also impacts on us. And so he's a spiritualist. He's able to really bring to bear, in his style of leadership, the efficacy of prayer and the power of prayer. Prayer that is able to give results.
In 1947, at the age of 55, Sheikh Usman was unanimously appointed Deputy National Chief Imam by chiefs of all the tribes represented in Muslim communities across Ghana and Islamic scholars. He initially declined the position but later accepted upon deeper meditation, consultations, and prayers. He held this position for 19 years until he was made the substantive National Chief Imam in 1993.
To be the national, or to be styled at least as National Chief Imam, is no mean position. But it depends on the personality, the person who holds the office. In the hands of another man, it could be but in the hands of a wise, spiritual person like the National Chief Imam, it's an office that brings people together, an office that is not divisive. It's an office that contributes to national harmony and peace, coexistence even among religions.
I think that he has impacted greatly in Ghana. And not only in Ghana, the Chief Imam, I also know, travels outside. And he goes to the Muslim communities outside. He mixes with them, he engages them, he knows their problem, he knows their issues. But you can imagine without the charisma and without the leadership of the National Chief Imam, you can imagine what the Muslim community would have been like. Because there were always issues in the Muslim community. And if for a very long time we've had peace, we haven't had issues of friction and fighting amongst the different doctrinal groups. And Muslims are at peace, even in times of politics.
Dr. Sheikh Usman Nuhu Shaributu, I consider my father.
The man Usman Nuhu Shaributu and what he stands for transcend everything, race, religion, and politics.
I must be honest with you, my first encounter was most probably a first falling in love with this grand old personality. There was a smile about him. There was a warmth about him that made me feel so much at ease, you know. So I would say he's always had this very attractive simplicity, mystic presence about himself. And that was one of the things that struck me immediately.
The previous imams that were there, either he had a political tint, a tribal color, or sectarian color. This, of course, was divisive. If you have a political color, that will mean that you will not be appreciated by those who don't belong to your political persuasion. If you have a tribal, leaning, it will mean that the other tribes will not accept you. If you are sectarian in nature, that will mean that the other sects will not accept you.
As far as the Chief Imam is concerned, it is not about being Muslim, or it's not about being non-Muslim. It's about being human. It's about humanity. And humanity is about serving the people, the way Allah wants the people to be served. So I think that just by virtue of the fact that the Chief Imam is showing all the charisma, all the awe, all the persona around him, he pulls people along with him. So if there is an issue and the Chief Imam goes to site, for instance, we heard of the Hoho issue, we heard of the Tafo issue, the Chief Imam doesn't sit in Accra, he moves. So the Chief Imam moves to Hoho, he moves to Pando, he moves to Tafo, and through the wisdom that Allah has given him for leadership, all he says to the young guys and the young men and the women, stop, and everything ceases.
Babu Shaka Malam irin yanda zaman lafiya da muke cikin kasan Ghana da kansa ya nuna cewa kaman tafiyar malam ya hada kowa da kowa. In ka lura wani kwanaki da aka ce wani fasa ya ce sarakai sun mutu, da aka mutane su sarakan sun samu gare shi mai ke yi, kowa ya mutu. To amma da aka ce shi ya mutu, da aka tashi abin da aka yi a cikin zango da shi fasa ya zo wurin malam, malam ya ce ina mutu. Mana malam inda za a yi dai babu shakka kowa ya mutu, amma yadda mu muka yin saboda muna son malam, da son da muka yi kamata mu yi malam irin son da ya kamata mu misa shine mu nemi zaman lafiya ko da wani lokaci, sannan mu je mu shirya abin da zai kawo alheri ya taimaki malam.
Usman Nuhu Shaributu is a maverick in many ways. On the eve of his centenary birthday, he visited a church in Ghana and sat through the worship. Not everyone was happy with this decision. Some critics condemned his actions as an abomination for a Muslim to participate in Christian worship. But Sheikh Shaributu emphasized that he was not in the church to worship, but to move the relationship between Christians and Muslims from mere tolerance to deeper engagement.
And I say this to the whole of the world. The original intention on that day was to visit two churches. He was intended to visit Pastor Otabel's church and then Christ the King. And that was something powerful he decided to do. It was, if you like, radical. It was revolutionary. That same day, because it was an Easter day, when Christians who were seven, who were worshiping in a church, were attacked by terrorists. I want to call them Muslim terrorists. They must be called just terrorists. But that, we must also accept the reality that those who did so claimed to be Muslims. They claimed to be Muslims. So that is the reality confronting us. So Chief Imam now drew the line so that if you want to judge Islam, between the action of the chief imam and the action of the terrorists who attacked Christians on Easter Day, which one of them will be the basis for your description for Islam?
For statesmen like former president and vice president of Ghana, Dr. Mahamudu Bawumia, that single step by the national chief imam is a giant leap for humanity to get close to a world in which religion does not become a barrier.
He's really a glue for this country, for all Muslims in this country. And we want to see him go. And it's already also a glue for all Christians in this country. He's really bringing all of us together. And Ghana is at peace because of his tolerance and strive for unity and understanding across all the religions. You know, I think that when he visited the Christ the King Church the other day, it made news on BBC. And many people were shocked, you know, to see the National Chief Imam celebrating his birthday by going to the Christ the King Church. That is the National Chief Imam. It's so remarkable that it made news on BBC World Service. And so that type of person we want to see live longer and longer and longer by the grace of God.
Doesn't it hit you as so refreshing to have the National Chief Imam's 100th birthday celebrated in a Christian church like Christ the King? Doesn't it quiz you? Doesn't it make you wonder what sort of man this great man is? So that's harmony. National Chief Imam going to tea with Christian cardinal, Catholic cardinal, or being eulogized at the Christ the King Catholic Church. So it's harmony, he said, harmony personified. That's how I see the National Chief Imam.
I believe that when the BBC says he's a light in the darkness, yes, more than a light. He's showing us the path to peace, political peace. He's showing us the path to harmony, you know, inter-ethnic harmony. He's showing us the path to, you know, how we should contribute to the greater development of this our dear country, Ghana, and beyond. For him to have made a gesture which is being talked about to date, when he celebrated his 100th birthday, that he passed through Christ the King Catholic Church to pray with the priest and the people there and to seek God's blessing. Unprecedented, he brought blessing and he received the blessing in return. And I thought this was something we should export to the whole world to show that in Ghana, Christians and Muslims have lived in peace with each other for centuries. And we can do it, and we should show people it is possible.
For someone who didn't have a shot at Western education, Sheikh Osman Nuhu Shaributu is passionate about both Islamic and Western education. He has translated that passion into action by institutionalizing the Sunset Fund.
The Sunset Fund was set up for a very good purpose, you know, and the history goes back to the time of ex-president Kufuor. And ex-president Kufuor was the one who inaugurated it. At the time, he had noticed that so many young people who want to pursue education are unable, and some come personally. I mean, having known him for his philanthropist, you know, inclinations, sometimes they come to him directly to want support. So, you know, and it was going beyond what he could contain. So the idea was to now establish, you know, that fund. And I think that from then on, a lot of people have benefited.
He is a towering figure for peace building in Ghana. The Grand Mufti serves as a member of the National Peace Council.
He has made himself a real gift to our country. And if there is something I want to follow, is to become a gift to our country. You know, it's not easy to make yourself a gift. It costs a lot of sacrifice. Be ready to be called upon. Be ready to welcome them. Be ready to sit and listen. But not only that, I know and I can tell you, he prays for this country always. And I would wish all of us religious leaders will make it a point to pray for our country. You see, here I am, Archbishop of Cape Coast. I can limit my prayer to Cape Coast, the Archdiocese of Cape Coast, Central Region. I think any religious leader must transcend political boundaries, religious boundaries, cultural boundaries. God has planted us here in this country. We must pray for the country. We must pray for the continent of Africa. We must pray for humanity. And that one I can tell you, anytime I've met the National Chief Imam, it comes out of him.
The exemplary leadership he has exhibited over the years has not gone unnoticed. Nations and institutions have recognized the impact he's had on peace building and have presented him with dozens of awards. In 2006, he received the annual Martin Luther King Jr. Award for Peace from the U.S. government. The University of Ghana in 2006 also bestowed on the National Chief Imam an honorary doctorate degree.
The department has a philosophy, and the philosophy is, yes, we are Muslims in Ghana, we are Christians in Ghana, some are traditionalists in Ghana. We believe in different ways of understanding God, but at the end of it, we have to live for peace and development. And that is what the department saw in the Chief Imam. They saw in the Chief Imam somebody who epitomizes peace, somebody who was just interested in nothing but peace. And there have been occasions where at certain places, the Chief Imam would have said, if I am going to be the cause of the problem, then I'll probably leave so that somebody else will come and then there will be peace. So this is a man who is selfless.
In 2019, the Poltava University of the Republic of Ukraine also conferred a doctorate degree on him. These and many other awards are testament of the trailblazing role of the man who started life on the street of Cow Lane and Zongo Lane in the central business district of Accra.
If Nobel Peace Prize is perceived as the hallmark of leadership or of peacemakers, or that's how they see him. So he should be entitled. I'm sure the people who have gotten Nobel Prizes that may not measure up even half the stature of the National Chief Imam. So I don't think it's too much for people to ask for that.
I think that if there was a double Nobel Peace Prize, then they should give it to him. You know, because I really believe that I agree with the former president, Jeye Kufuor, and that is another very wise man that God has gifted this country, you know. But his view that you should have the Chief Imam as a Nobel Prize, Peace Prize winner, I will endorse that if the people of the Nobel Committee will see it that way, or we'll take a look here in Ghana and see the contribution of the National Chief Imam to peace in Ghana. It's amazing, and he's acknowledged, huh? Not just in Ghana. You go to Senegal, go to Nigeria, go to Morocco. I mean, they want him everywhere because he exudes that peace, you know. In fact, I like to hold his hand a lot of the time because it's so calming.
I wholeheartedly endorse it. Now, if the Nobel, you know, Foundation could look and accord a person like the National Chief Imam that recognition of being a unifier, of being somebody who has come to understand the deepest, call it, gift of belonging to religion. Giving him a Nobel Prize will not be only for the benefit of Islam, will not be only for the good of country Ghana. It would be to acknowledge the importance of religion in the political, social, economic development of humanity.
His theology, his understanding of theology, that provides the fountain for the wisdom he uses as a tool to facilitate peace. And these, I think these are subject for full lengthy lectures. He's a whole subject of research that we must continuously, so that even if he's no more, we can discuss him in bits or in parts.
Recognition and awards continue to pour in recognition of the exceptional leadership of the National Chief Imam. In February 2020, the highly revered King of the Asante Kingdom, Otumfuo Osei-Tutu II, nominated him as recipient of the 2020 Millennium Excellence Award.
Each time I've had a chance to come before you, I'm blessed by your demeanor, your attitude, and the way you embrace all. I remember the last time you yourself, you were putting my collar, my Christian collar, for me together. I just enjoyed that one. The Chief Imam knows very much how strong a Christian I am, how diehard I want to do crusades in the Independence Square. I remember at one of my Methodist crusades at the Independence Square, some of my boys were pasting their posters around the Fadama areas. There was this young fanatic Muslims who said, no, this is not a Christian place and things. And I was told, so I drove to the Chief Imam. He laughed and he told them that, look, we're all the same God. And so some of those things make sense. And you'll be surprised, some of those boys became even part of those who helped us paste the posters.
In the 90s,
when the country's central mosque was razed to the ground by authorities. His posturing and calm words to agitated Muslim youth who planned to show their disapproval towards the regime quelled what would have been a bloody confrontation.
The Rawlings yana cikin waɗanda suka bata da musulmai rai cikin Ghana. Domin shi yazo ya fasa Central Mosque na Ghana Accra. Chief Imam ce a kale shi ya fasa. Ya fasa. Ai ya kamata ya fushi da shi. Shi bai fushi da shi ba ya doki kaman Allah ne ya sa aka yi haka. Da ya doki wannan ya mai da shi daga Allah ne. Sai kaga yau Allah ya ba mu kanda. West Africa masallaci daya da suka yi. Kaga bannan da aka yi Allah ya gyara mana shi. Duka an kurin National Chief Imam.
This is why I continue to describe him as a wise man. He didn't wear his office on his sleeve, as people say, showing off like the big man, the leader of the Islamic community of Ghana. No, no, no. He came round like the father that he is, quietly to touch you, to talk with you, like in one-to-one relationship, which would make you. You will prick your conscience and make you do the right thing at any given time. And to me, that's the hallmark of wisdom.
In a world where we see people sometimes present Islamic figures in a very divisive manner, you know, and sort of preaching fire and brimstone and all of that. No, that National Chief Imam is calm. He's very peaceful, he's very understanding. He wants everybody to get on very well.
If you disturb peace, if you disturb peace, this man gets shaken. For example, when Reverend Osu Bempa came out with his prognostications about those who were going to die and so on and so forth. And Chief Imam was on the list. Personally, it didn't affect him. And he never felt threatened. He never felt afraid. He's a very calm person, understands the spirituality of death. But as he got angered, he gave us instruction to quickly go and stop them. And that's, in fact, that's, I used that mandate. I'm the one he spoke to. To use that mandate to speak first on the airwaves. And once the message went, it was enough to quell that.
For Vice President Dr. Muhammadu Bawumia, the National Chief Imam is not just a leader of the Muslim community. He has become a spiritual godfather.
He has so much that he has to offer, not just to me, but to many, many people. But spiritually, he is so clean. And the Chief Imam is really the model that if you wanted to strive towards perfection on earth, is the sort of person you would like to be. And so for us, you have to appreciate him. And I see him as a spiritual.
Together and worship peacefully under the leadership of the Grand Mufti.
Prior to, most of them even thought that Ahmadiyyat was against Islam, and some of them believed that Ahmadiyyat has been planted by Israel with the backing of the United States of America to infiltrate the ranks of Muslims and undo Islam for and on behalf of the Zionists. Prior to him, like I said, Al-Sunnah man had nothing doing with a Shiite. A Shiite had nothing doing with a Tijani. Tijani, on the other hand, had nothing doing with Ahlus Sunnah and a Shiite. And the three of them combined had nothing doing with an Ahmadi Muslim. The Ahmadi Muslim was ostracized kind of on one side. The others were the lesser evil. And to them, the Ahmadis were the major evil. But what do we do? And what do we see since the National Chief Imam came on board as the National Chief Imam? He has been the type who reaches out. He's been the type who is all-embracing. He's been the type who is fatherly. And he's been the type who has become an umbrella.
And I think the Chief Imam, as a human being, really knows the purpose of his life on earth. The Chief Imam sees himself as a servant of Allah. He sees himself as an abd, and he sees himself as a Khalifa of Allah on earth. Therefore, it is not surprising that as I did my research amongst people wanting to know about the Chief Imam, people had all sorts of things to say about the Chief Imam. People could not describe the Chief Imam. They couldn't find words to describe the Chief Imam. But somebody made a statement, which for me is immense. And the person said, the Chief Imam is such a person that he's so accessible, he's so kind, he's so humble that even if you ask him to come to your house and slaughter a fowl to celebrate your daughters, he would come.
The Canada Malian National Chief Imam, Sheikh Al-Hiri, the yanda Allah jalla wa ala ya hada han kullamu da malam ya sa komen mu irin da yanda ake gaddama wai wanga sune kaza duka ya wuce domin me shi addinin musulunci namu ne kowa ya goda hanyar da yake bi ya kira mutane zuwa gare shi amma cewa kamar da mu muka dauki abin ikan zama tashin hankali da fada duka zamanin malam duka ya wuce domin malam ya iya ya hada yan shi'a ne yan sunna ne yan tariqa ne duka ya hada mu wuri daya kuma yana shawara da al'umma annabi Muhammad baki daya to babu shakka dai tunda dai ni dai da na tashi dai limaman da nake gani ne ba ta samu irin malam ba yasa ubangiji Allah ne ya bashi kuma Allah ya taimaka masa ya harkan al'umma ubangijin Allah sai zama haka nan har karshen mu.
Sheikh Nuhu Sharbutu is a very thoughtful leader. The reverence of the Chief Imam attracts and keeps all the sects together to embrace the core principle of Islam, peace.
There are a number of times that the Imam of the Tijaniyah, Imam of Ahlul Sunnah, Imam of Shiites, the Amir, a missionary in charge, or if you want to say the Imam of the Ahmadiyya Muslim community, have met. And we virtually have a platform now. And we meet from time to time. And there is no single Muslim group today who is not comfortable coming to the Ahmadiyya Muslim Mission, calling on me or me going to him. In the past, if any would want to do that, he would come under the cover of darkness so that he is not seen by the other Muslims and branded a hypocrite. He has become an icon in our current dispensation. Nobody can deny that. Being an icon that he is, there should be a monument in honor of him. Whatever that takes, a form that will take, that is subject to discussions. But it's not somebody who should pass on and alongside him the name and the good things that he has done. Something must be there to represent his memory, so that generations that will come later will come to know that, yes, there was an icon of this nature. And this is how he went about things.
That progressive approach and interpretation of the texts of the Noble Quran and the Hadith have stirred and brought about subconscious reformation of otherwise radical Muslim minds.
He is an honest person. He loves, he is compassionate, his purity in the heart, he's warm in the heart, he is gentle, he is austere, he has candor, he cares, he's sympathetic to the weak, he's very empathetic to people. He likes to build relationships that are pure and that are authentic. I think that this for me is the summary of the secret that has shot him up high above even other scholars of his generation.
I'm proud of my Lankwara do me in the Wanini. I got a Shini National Chief Imam.
Sheikh Mustafa Ya Jalala is a proud student of the National Chief Imam, who now manages the Islamic Training Institute at Kanda in Accra. He recounts the style and methodology of the man he considers the best teacher ever.
Muna da wani abu muna cewa nizam. Larba suna ce nizam. Hausawa suna cewa tsari, tsari. To inda lokacin nan yanda malam ke tafiya da gwada karatu cikin zaure da kuma yanda yake rubutawa kan board ana gwada karatu, to gaskiya da yau in dai ta hanyar tsari ne yadda ake ce mai professor ko doctor ya kai ga haka. Na tunawa ya yi mini wani abu na yi mamaki. Wani ya zo yana neman a bashi riga. Domin na yi karatu cikin maganan gada nake gaya muku ga. Sai malam ya fito da riga, domin lokacin nake wanke rigunan malam. Ni na wanke rigunan malam kuma na press ni. To abin da nake so in gwada maka, na koyi wani abu wurin shi. Sai ya fito da riga. Sai ya ce, rigan ga yana da kyau. Sai ya ce, yana da kyau, amma baka taba sawa ba. Sai ya sake tambaya na, rigan ga yana da kyau. Ya ce, malam yana da kyau, amma baka taba sawa ba. Sai ya sake, rigan ga yana da kyau. Na ce, yana da kyau, to je ka ba shi. Wanda ya zo ina, you see, ni na gani kaman bai taba sawa ba. Ka gane, ya je a sake. Ce shi kuma yana tambaya na, yana da kyau. Na ce, yana da kyau, amma baka taba sawa ba. So shi ma da yana neman ya gan kaman abu mai kyau ya doki. To shi ne ma na yi karatun wannan, ban manta da wannan. So shi yau haka, in dai na yi wani ya zo wurina yana neman abu, ina ba shi mai kyau ne, ba wanda ban so zan doke in ba shi ba.
He may be a disciplinarian, but the National Chief Imam also has a sense of humor.
you most people don't see that side of him. When you go out, you see him, and he's generally a quiet person, you know. But you know, he can crack a few jokes. And I remember performing Hajj with him in Saudi Arabia, and we had we shared in the same tents and so on. We shared some good conversations and all of that. And this is what Hajj does, and everybody is brought at the same level.
The National Chief Imam has gone ahead to establish the Islamic Peace and Security Council to promote peace not only in Ghana but globally.
Old man, but you see him with people who could be his children age-wise, and you listen, then comment every now and then, and the comments you would make would be full of wisdom, without pretenses, without being judgmental. You know, you wouldn't get the feeling this is a man of God talking down to you or no. You would come down to earth, talk with you. And then, of course, normally before, he would ask you to pray.
He's also a loving husband. Nobody walks into Sheikh Usman Nuhu Sharbutu's compound hungry and walks out on an empty stomach. There is always something to eat and drink, and the wives have been instrumental in this direction. Sheikh Usman Nuhu Sharbutu has lived for more than 100 years. It's a life well lived, a life of impact, honor, dignity, peace, and a total devotion to Allah. He's transformed hearts and minds and greatly affected generations in ways that straddle religious, political, and ethnic barriers.
Allah, بشير النبي.